saved. Yahweh doesn't deal in numbers, numbers. Yahweh only deals in faith. Tell me, will you go the distance or fall by the way? I wouldn't get too careless. There's still a lot of room in the lake. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Take a look, 8 souls were saved. Now that's not a multitude, but a warning to behave, yeah. And do you have the right stuff? I mean the spirit of the sun. Getting ready will not be enough. When the universal revelation comes, are you faithful, diligent and true? Believing on his son, the one who died for you. Are you faithful, committed to the run? Yahweh gave his only son for you, for you. The love of many has grown cold, long gone astray. They wouldn't wait for the promise, eternal life away. Gave their souls to the devil, turned their backs on the sun, yeah. Now they got no excuse, for they would not believe that he would overcome. Are you faithful, diligent and true, believing on his son, the one who died for you? Are you faithful, committed to the run? Yahweh gave his soul. All your eyes on the king, heart set on the prize is the song that you sing. This gospel of life, are you ready for the change? Fought a good fight, do you know your name? Is it blotted in the book of life? Are you giving diligence that your election's sure? Are you holy, are you blameless, and is your conscience pure? Are you dressed in a white robe that's been washed in his blood, yeah? Are you sealed with a kiss? Are you a prisoner of his love? Are you faithful, diligent and true, believing on his son, the one who died for you? Are you faithful,
good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5, that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that every lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabets that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know that name. So the simple, yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is structured and functioned according to this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among man whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have the class dedicated in prayer by Dr. Vassell Mack. We will have that followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be 2 Samuel, the 24th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Mack.
Hey, good morning and afternoon, brethren. Let us bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, we truly thank you so much for calling us, delivering us from darkness, by revealing yourself to us through Yahshua the Messiah. Keep us, Father, keep us steadfast. Keep us grounded in truth and in love. Show us the importance of actually being here. It's really, really serious. It is imperative for our souls to continue to learn and appreciate being called in here. Let us not take any of this for granted. And again, we just thank you We thank you. In your only begotten Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Our scripture lesson will be taken from 2 Samuel, the 24th chapter, page 427, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts. revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. 2 Samuel, the 24th chapter. And again, the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Israel, and he moved David against them to say, "Go number Israel and Judah." For the king said to Joab, the captain of the host, which was with him, "Go now through all the tribes of Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, and number ye the people, that I may know the number of the people." And Joab said unto the king, "Now Yahweh thy Elohim added unto the people, how many soever they be, an hundredfold, and that the eyes of my master the king may see it. But why does my master the king delight in this thing?" Notwithstanding, the king's word prevailed against Joab and against the captains of the host. And Joab and the captains of the host went out from the presence of the king to number the people of Israel. And they passed over Jordan and pitched in Aroer on the right side of the city that lieth in the midst of the river of Gad, and toward Jezer. Then they came to Gilead and to the land of Tadim Hatshid, and they came to Dan John and about to Zidon, and came to the stronghold of Tyre, and to all the cities of the Hivites and the Canaanites, and they went out to the south of Judah, even to Beersheba. So when they had gone through all the land, they came to Jerusalem at the end of 9 months and 20 days. And Joab gave unto the sum of the number of the people unto the king. And there were in Israel 800,000 valiant men that drew the sword, and the men of Judah was 500,000 men. And David's heart smote him after that he had numbered the people. And David said unto Yahweh, "I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Yahweh, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly." For when David was up in the morning, the sword of Yahweh came unto the prophet Gad, David's seer, saying, "Go and say unto David, thus saith Yahweh, I offer thee three things. Choose the thing, one of them, that I may do it unto thee." So Gad came to David and told him and said unto him, "Shall 7 years of famine come unto thee in thy land? Or wilt thou flee 3 months before thine enemy while they pursue thee? Or that there be 3 days pestilence in thy land? Now advise and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me." And David said unto Gad, "I am in a great strait. Let us fall now into the hand of Yahweh, for his mercies are great, and let me not fall into the hand of man." So Yahweh sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning evening to the time appointed, and there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. And when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, Yahweh repented him of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, "It is enough. Stay now thy hand." And the angel of Yahweh was by the threshing place of Araunah the Jebusite. And David spake unto Yahweh when he saw the angel that smote the people and said, "Lo, I have sinned and I have done wickedly. But these sheep, what have they done? Let thy hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house." And Gad came that day to David and said unto him, "Go up, rear an altar unto Yahweh in the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusites." And David, according to the saying of Gad, went up as Yahweh commanded. And Araunah looked and saw the king and his servant coming on towards him. And Araunah went out and bowed himself before the king on his face upon the ground. And Araunah said, "Wherefore is my master the king come to his servant?" And David said, "To buy the threshing floor of thee, to build an altar unto Yahweh, that the plague may be stayed from the people." And Araunah said unto David, "Let my master the king take an offering up what seemeth good unto him. Behold, here be oxen for burnt sacrifice, and threshing instruments, and other instruments of the oxen for wood." All these things did Araunah, as the king give unto the king. And Araunah said unto the king, "Yahweh thy Elohim accept thee." And the king said unto Araunah, "Nay, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto Yahweh my Elohim of that which doth cost me nothing." So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. And David built there an altar unto Yahweh and offered burnt offering and peace offering. So Yahweh was entreated for the land, and the plague was stayed from Israel. I have read 2 Samuel, the 24th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Dr. Mack, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. Today is Sunday. We have a lecture format today. For our first speaker, I would like to call on Dr. Samuel Salas. Dr. Salas.
Thank you very much. Good morning, class.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's a pleasure to stand before you and say certain things Yahweh allowed me to say. First of all, yesterday was my birthday, but I don't like to be celebrated, but nevertheless, if people say be happy or whatever, that's fine, thank you. We are here to learn about Yahweh's purpose. And we can say what Yahweh allowed us to say, no more than that. Mm-hmm. And I've been in the school for so long and learning so little. I know it's not right, but this is the way Yahweh works. See, I belong to this school, the place of the highest learning, since 1971. It's a long time, it's a life. I have the privilege to see the founder of this school, Henry Clifford Kingley, Ms. Dr. Gross and Mary Gross, Dennis Dullard, Robert Harris, and also I see Snell Baker speak about two or three times in 1040 Grand Los Angeles. And he didn't say no more than what the founder say. It was right in the money. He's, yes, repeat, looks like a tepicora. And I was bring to this class for my friend of mine who was from South America, Uruguay, Juan Angel González Ximeno. And also, we pull the car with George Prieto, Kerry Woodland, and myself, Samuel Salas. It's a long time ago, but looks like yesterday, because I am in the right place, I know that. I went for a week for vacation to Baja. Beautiful things, the ocean, the land, everything's wonderful. But all those things I see fade away little by little. And I cannot remember the way I want to remember. But this teaching, I don't remember the whole thing I want to, but remember something made me very happy, because every day I see more than I didn't see before. Like, for instance, this scripture we have today, 2 Samuel 24 chapter, it talk about the, it's in the Numbers, in the Bible, say about the Yahweh ordered to count the people when they come up out of Egypt. And they make a census of 603,550 fighting men, not counting the women, children, and all men. And later on, they make a second census before entering the promised land or crossing the River Jordan. And that census was a little shorter because they spent, the Hebrews spent 40 years in the wilderness, 40 years for disobeying Yahweh. Because when Moses sent the people to spy the land, they were promised one of each tribe. And 10 came with a bad report. And only 2 came with a right report, which was one, Caleb and Joshua. And the other 10 people, because they sent one of each tribe, they say, those people are giants, big, strong, in the cities have a big surrender. They protected the walls, are protected. We look like a grasshopper to them. They can defeat us. But Caleb said, no. We have Yahweh on our side. We can defeat them. And the people start murmuring, saying things, and Caleb say, no, Yahweh is on our side. Let's go and defeat those people. So Yahweh didn't like this. So this is why they went 40 days to spy the land. And Yahweh, for each day, he make a year. They were in the wilderness for 40 years. The third census, not supposed to, because Yahweh didn't order. But reading the Bible, Yahweh put in David's mind to make the census. Looks like he was disobedient, but no. It was Yahweh's purpose. And I just find out today. And one of his relatives, I think Joab was his uncle. He sent to census from Beersheba to Dan, who was from the north to the south, all the way to census the people, because they were ready to go to war against the Palestinians, and there were so many people, he was not too sure he can win. He wanted to know how many people he can count on. And they went, Joab went over and census the people, and he count 800,000 Israelites from the north, and from the south, he count 500,000. Mm-hmm. So Yahweh didn't like this because he didn't order to make the third census. And he said, well, I know I did, David said, I know I did wrong. I'm not supposed to order to count the people because we trust Yahweh and we can win. He win all the war for us. But he was told, he can, there is three things. He can choose one of those three. 7 years famine, no rain at all. And with that, many people will perish. And the second choice was, it can be hunted for 3 months with the enemy. Mm-hmm. Because if the enemy catch him in 3 months or before 3 months, they can torture him and they can kill him. And he don't want to be tortured. And the third thing, or the third shoes he can make, it was 3 days pestilence. Mm-hmm. And since he said, oh, it's only 3 days. Oh, go ahead. I choose the 3 days pestilence. But so many people die for those 3 days. 70,000 people, mm-hmm. till the killing is ended the third day. So you're not supposed to make the third census because Yahweh didn't tell him, but it was in Yahweh's mind anyway. In the fourth census, when Joshua born, the Romans ordered that this one. But we don't have the quantity. This is the question I have for myself. The census, how many people the Romans count? Because they were, the Romans, they were afraid of the Hebrew. They were so many. And like I mentioned, we are in the right place. And this teaching never fed away. It's all the time in our mind. It's unbelievable, but this is the way it is. And I have some readings in here, but when I all the time want to read something, I all the time forget. See, the Hebrew, they used to live in Egypt for 400 years as a servants. They know, they have the promise, they will be delivered and give them the land they were promised. See, they waiting for someone very powerful, like a king. Same way, the Hebrews, they used to wait for someone, a king, to deliver them, who was Yahshua the Messiah. But he didn't look so big, nice looking, and powerful or rich. He just looked like a normal man. They don't believe he was the Savior. And they miss him. So they miss him all the time. Even it's with us, all the time and never leave us alone by ourselves. He's everywhere. He knows our thinking. He knows the past. And he knows the future. He knows all and all. See, we hear those charts in here, beautiful, wonderful. This is the history. This history never ends. The way begin, the way it will close. Everything came from pure spirit. We have matter. Matter is a spirit materialized, no more than that. The atom or the cell, neutron, proton, and electron. Cell, nucleus, nucleus, and cell body, right. That's a cell. See, there's nothing escape the pattern.
That's right.
Look at this. How beautiful it is. Yahweh, nobody see the Father. It's pure spirit. Invisible. Nobody see the Father at any time. But he showed himself through the Son, Elohim. Elohim is the only divine title of Yahweh in a shape and form of a man without flesh and blood. See? Yahweh is symbolized with a cloud. We say Yahweh is not a cloud, but he is a cloud. Because there is nothing, it's not Yahweh. He is a cloud. By transmutation, he became Elohim. Transmutation. Just think in this word, transmutation. Something you don't see, and pop, you see, became. This is the way he told Moses. When Moses went on top of the mountain, he went there. But before he went on the top of the mountain, he was taking care of the goats of his father-in-law. And one day, a bush was on fire. And never ended. It kept going in fire. But he was very curious, and he wanted to go and see what or who put the fire or helping. But before that, he heard a voice, Moses, Moses, take your shoes off because the land you're standing is a holy land. See, everything is 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, and 3. Atom and cell. Mm-hmm. Present, past, mm-hmm. and future. The tabernacle, 1, 2, 3. Go run about, holy place, and most holy place. 1, 2, 3. And there is nothing, is not three. Even Yahweh himself is and the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have here the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Why I say Elohim is the Son? Because when Yahweh speak to Moses and the mountain Sinai, We represent Yahweh as a cloud. He told him, Aya Asher Aya. Means, I will be what I want to be. I can be anything I want. There is nothing I cannot be. It's not I am the what I am. That's wrong. Because if you are something, that's the only thing you are. And you are anything, you are whatever you think, even you think. See, when Yahweh had his son, this is the beginning of all creation. Moses see how everything became to exist. You see a rerun like a movie because the creation already was. This is, it's hard to understand. Moses see a vision. You see this vision in 40 days, the second trip, he went to the mountain. 7 days in the creation, 6 days plus the one Yahweh rest is 7. The rest 33 days, he was receiving the instruction how to build this tabernacle. 1, 2, 3. It's a hard job how to build this tabernacle. Moses came down. Before Moses went up in the mountain, he went the first time to the plateau and he received the law. He came to the people and talked to the people. The people say, Moses, we don't want Yahweh to talk about to us because the earthquakes and the rocks break and it's too noisy. We are afraid. Whatever the Creator wants us to do, we do it. But you tell us what he wants and we do it. Moses say, okay. And it was the first trip. But he went alone and by himself. This is one of the mysteries till now. It was Yahweh told him to go alone and by himself to the mountain. But he rose up in the morning and his minister Joshua, and they both went up to the mountain. Looks like he was a disobedient man. He wasn't. Because the one invited him, it was Joshua, Moses' minister. He was by himself. The one with him is the one invited him. And 70 people, the elders, stay behind. And also Aaron and his two sons, Nadab and Abihu, watching Elohim, but they only watch. They can do anything. So Moses stayed in the mountain for 40 days. Too many days. The elders and Aaron and his two sons, they came down and said, oh, this Moses is, I don't know what he's doing down there. We come down. They came with the rest of the people here. And when Moses received and he see the creation, how everything became to exist, and he received the 33 days instruction how to build the tabernacle, and he came down after all that time. But the people say, this Moses who bring us out of Egypt is probably dead. Nobody can survive for no food for so many, for so long. And they went to Aaron. Because Moses told his brother Aaron, whatever the people ask you, help them. Do it. We go up in the mountain, and you are in charge, Aaron. And Aaron say, okay, I'll do that. And when Moses didn't came too soon, the people tell Aaron, Aaron, build us something, an idol that can we can worship and say, he is the one bring us out of Egypt. And Aaron, he didn't hesitate. He said, okay, tell your sons and your daughters, take the gold from the earrings and throw in there to see what's come out. What they built, a cast golden calf. And they were worshiping that golden calf. They were told not to worship no idol from silver, gold, metal, or wood. No worship. It's very jealousy. And this, it's only less than 40 days, and look at what they were doing. What they told not to do. When Moses was coming down with the table stone, because Yahweh gave him those stones, and his minister told him, I hear a noise of war in the camp. This is the camp. And Moses said, no, it's not a noise of war. It's a noise of festivity. Because Yahweh told Moses what's happening in there. Oh, you people is corrupt. They're doing something I told not to do. He came down very mad and angry. And when he see people worshiping the idol, he got so angry, and the table stone, it threw down and break it. It was purposed that way too. Mm-hmm. It was purposed by Yahweh. Why? Because there was no place to put the stones. Was no, the ark was not built yet, the ark of the covenant. So was no place, because they, after the third time Moses went up in the mountain, he had to carve the stone the same dimension, and Yahweh will write down the law or repeat the same thing, but he had to take the stones by himself. The second trip, when Moses came, tell Aholiab to build this tabernacle with what? See, when the Hebrews came out of Egypt after the 10 devastated plagues, Pharaoh and the people told Moses, get out of here. Too many things happening to us. Even our firstborn dying. Even Pharaoh's son died. Go away from Egypt. We don't want you here. You and your people, get out of here. But the people, before abandon the land of Egypt, they request the women and the men for things, gold, silver, material, wood, and they carry with them. And with those items, they build this tabernacle. Even people start donating things till Moses tell, hey, please don't bring no more things. We have enough. That's Yahweh's purpose too. Look at that. Because they have enough material to build this tabernacle. Same is when Yahweh, pure spirit, his son became Elohim, he no need more than what he need. He don't need the whole thing to become Elohim. As simple as that. This is why the tabernacle is a type and shadow of Elohim. Because Elohim transformed, like those toys, Transformers. Elohim transformed in three part tabernacle. And the creation starts to develop. In a blink of an eye, blink, yes, right away. One of the important things, everything is very important, but one of the most important things was men. When I say men, it's a year of the women too. It's a man and a woman, hermaphrodite. See, men match with this tabernacle. We have a picture of that in here. Nice systems, nice furniture, principal furniture. One, two, three. The physical body, breaking the physical body. One, two, three. Head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. One, two, three. Nazi escape the tree. Look at how simple is this. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yahshua is the Holy Spirit. This is why they don't know him. Pure Spirit. They see the flesh, but they understood him. Till he was sacrificed, buried, and resurrected. After that, they have the understanding. But when he was alive, no, they didn't understand. The 12 disciples, they just followed them. Disciple mean a student. And they miss him. Then, and they miss him now. Only few people have the understanding. What is this all about? Those histories of the Bible are wonderful. I enjoy reading and reading again. It's a message. And have all those histories concerning the Savior. Nothing else. Everything is purpose from the beginning. How begin and how end. Let me tell you. The ones are or belong to this teaching, who the seven angels bring those from what he was revealed, Henry Clifford Kinley. He knows he's still here. His teaching is here. His spirit is here. is the seventh angel. No question about. You don't hear those things anywhere. Only in this teaching. The history of Adam and Eve. First of all, Yahweh made Adam. But one of his ribs, Yahweh put Adam to sleep. And from one rib, he made the woman. She was inside him. They were Adam. Means red, both. But Yahweh called her later on Eve. Adam and Eve. Because Yahweh said, hey, it's by himself. Let's make him a companion. And Yahweh made Eve out of him. This picture is so beautiful. There is so much. You can spend days and days explaining what's happening here. And the story never ended. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. How begin and how will end. See, everything goes to pure spirit the way things begin.
That's right.
See, the first man see this thing, how it happened, was Moses. Was revealed to him how everything became to exist. Pure spirit, it was taken to the third heaven. Eternity time. Eternity. You see the whole thing in eternity. We came from eternity. And to the eternity, we go. As simple as that. Life. Our human being is at the average, used to be 70, they say now it's only 65 after COVID-19. It's 70 years. Sometimes men live 100 or a little bit over 100, like we have in history, like we have in a lifetime. My uncle, the last time I saw him was about 3 years ago, a little bit over. He was 95. My mother, when she passed, was 89. My aunt was 95. I don't know about myself. Yesterday was my birthday, 80. And I am not as strong as I used to be. I used to jump. Run? No anymore. Now I hardly walk and I be looking the floor for not to fall. There is any object or something to strike my path. I be very carefully to the, this I am in Yahweh's hand. He want me to live more except to him. I accepted. I am so happy what I can say things going on because I know it's Yahweh's purpose. I ask myself, why this thing happened this way? But I react and say, oh, it's Yahweh's purpose. I don't have to mess with that. it's not my. Yeah, it's his. And this 2 Samuel 24 chapter, I write this in one of the books. Sometimes I used to write a lot. But I remember I wrote about the three countings of the people. Two were ordered by Yahweh. And the last one, the one David did, Yahweh didn't tell David count the people, but he put this thing in his mind to count it. Otherwise, he didn't do it. It was Yahweh's purpose. You can go and read. But this is very beautiful. Like I say, things going on is wonderful. We have to enjoy in this life love, peace, and joy. But the most beautiful thing of those three things is love. We have to love each other because we only have one chance in this world. We are like a doves. The doves fly away, like passing through. This is the way we are in life. We are as a dove passing through. Many people from the past, they went away. I was watching the cell phone. Too many movie stars gone. Man, incredible, famous, rich. And I say, oh, I'm still here. Thank you, Yahweh. Thank you for keeping me here learning about your purpose. I learn a little bit every day, but I learn. And I hope everyone watching us, they have something and they learn something from this. But you are in the right place for learning. Thank you so much and have a beautiful day. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Beautiful. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas. I'll be your next speaker. I appreciated the remarks from the previous speaker. I'm very happy and glad to be able to stand before you and give a testimony of anything that I've come to know and understand since coming down to one of these schools. And as I just said, I really appreciated the remarks from the previous speaker, and a lot of what he was talking about is just stood out. And you might say, how so, if you've been coming to these classes frequently? Because a lot of what Dr. Salas was speaking on was what we go into many times. We repeat these things over and over again, but it's through the repetition that we come to gain some sort of knowledge and understanding of the things, just like you teach a kid over and over and over again. They make mistakes and you redirect them and correct them, and you know, eventually the light comes on, which is likened unto that flash of the Shekinah. And it's this simplicity that we want you to see. This thing is so simple. One, two, three. If you can count to three, you can know something about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And if you can't count to three, Yahweh's got you taken care of. The previous speaker was talking, and when he was going through what he was going through, what stood out to me was Yahweh has declared the end of the situation that we all want, our end goal, the end of it all, was declared from the very beginning. Your final destination has already been mapped out. People will get upset sometimes when you say that thing like predestination. It's predestined. Is it predestined if I come up and bonk you on the head for saying that? Yeah, it is. It is. What we want you to do is be aware of that. See, everything that exists has been predestined. Give me Revelations, the first chapter. Where it says, I am the Alpha and Omega. Somewhere. Yeah, pick it up at the train of thought. There. You can start at one if you want.
Revelations. 1:1. The revelation of Yahshua the Messiah, which Yahweh gave unto him to show unto his servant things which must shortly come to pass.
All right, slow down. Because, look, this is what we want for you to have. This is what we all desire. There is no reason to come down here if you're not coming down here to receive the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. And I know sometimes we don't mean it. Sometimes we call the book Revelations, but there's only one.
Yes. Right.
There's only one revelation unto Yahshua the Messiah. And that's what we are here to receive. You've got the vision painted all around this room and on all of these different charts. Behind me here, this is some of the vision that the founder of this school had drawn out to explain the purpose of Yahweh according to Yahweh's pattern so that you can know something about his plan. You need a revelation to go along with the vision. As it said, this chart looks like scrambled eggs to the untrained eye. But once you come down here and through repetition and going through these things, you will start to understand why somebody points here or here or here or here. Or here. This is where we're at right now reading. But if you didn't know anything about this chart, then you wouldn't know that what we're reading right here in the book of Revelation is talking about the beginning of this vision that John was having on the Isle of Patmos, which is an island which is just like a mountain, just surrounded by water. Same thing. Yeah. This is, go ahead and read. Just
Revelation 1:1. Mm-hmm. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bore record of the word of Yahweh and of the testimony of Yahshua the Messiah and all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the word of this prophecy.
He bore record of all the things that he saw. Basically, he is a witness to everything that Moses. That, in a nutshell, John is made a witness to absolutely everything that Moses seen when he was taken up and had this vision on Patmos. Okay? Continue to read.
And keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand.
See, now, what I just said, you didn't know that before you came into one of these schools. Nobody in your church, your synagogue, or any other place that you done went to, unless you done came down to one of these schools or had a conversation with somebody who has been exposed to one of these schools, nobody has ever told you that what John seen and what John was writing is the self same thing that Moses. It witnesses to what Moses wrote.
Right.
Nobody told you that. That's a great mystery to the world. They don't know nothing about the correlation between John and Moses or any of the other prophets or apostles. They just think it's cunningly devised fables. And we know in the book, you're not supposed to, fall under the guise of those cunningly devised fables. We're supposed to prove everything that we believe. And we have a measure of this tabernacle, 1, 2, 3, that we can use to prove all of these things. We can use this pattern in this tabernacle to prove that everything that Yahweh declared from the beginning is what will be in the end.
Right.
Continue to read. Hopefully
Four.
We get into this.
I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end.
I am the first. You see right here? I am the first and the last, the beginning and the ending. Mm-hmm. Read.
Said Yahweh Elohim, which is and which was, and which is to come,
which
the Almighty.
Is, which was, and which is to come. See, in the moderation, we explain that Yahweh is pure spirit. That he is the ultimate source.
Right.
The ultimate substance. The ultimate limits. And the ultimate bounds of absolutely everything, ultimately, everything, if you will. There is nothing that escapes Yahweh. He is the all in all, and that is all. Let me see that. Not right now. Just wait. I apologize. He is the all in all, and that is all. He declared the end from the beginning. Continue reading in Revelation.
5. John, to the seven assemblies which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, unto him that beloved us and washed us from our sins.
See, Yahshua
in his
the
own
Messiah
blood.
Is, read that again. Unto Yahshua the Messiah. We're starting at Yahshua there.
And from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness.
See, Yahshua is the one that is given John anything to know of Yahweh. We read over in Matthew, where Yahshua says that no man can come unto the Father except the Son. Mm-hmm. And no man know the Son save the Father, if I got that right. So if John here on Patmos has anything to say about Yahweh, then he must have got it from Yahshua. Mm-hmm. You got to keep that in mind when you're trying to learn and know something about your Heavenly Father, that you're going to get it from His Son, His only begotten Son. And that ought to give you some joy to know and understand that you receive some knowledge and understanding of your Father, and to understand that the only place that you could have got it from is Yahshua. Mm-hmm. That's the only place you could have got it from. But he lived some 2,000 years ago. Walked the Judean earth plane and healed the blind and the lepers and the sick and the maimed and brought people back from the dead and then got caught up and got hanged himself and died. Mm. And then the people said that they seen him again. Yeah. That Yahshua. And it took his name and changed it. Made it Jesus. That one. Now, you can't know nothing about the Father. It says you go through him. Hope, where you at? 1 John 4? Is it 2 and 4? This is 1 John 4 and 2. 4 and 1.
1 John 4 and 1. Mm-hmm. Beloved, believe not every spirit.
Now we're talking about spirit. Oh, now we done got abstract. See, Yahweh is spirit. You can't taste, touch, smell, feel, hear spirit. So it necessitated Yahweh to take on shape and form in his sonship degree in order to have some sort of expression that can be recognized. Mm-hmm. Do you follow me now? So we're talking about spirit taking on shape and form and manifesting, crystallizing in the physical body. 1, 2, 3. That's all you need to know something about your Heavenly Father. Now, don't believe every spirit. Because mm-hmm. there's a spirit out there that's going to lie to you. We all been lied to. Each and every one of us has told a lie. If you tell me you ain't never lied, you a liar.
That's right.
Continue to read, please.
Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirit whether they are of Yahweh.
See? You got to try them spirits. Somebody tell you something? All right, where's the proof? People used to say, I look good. I don't care too much. People used to say, I should model. I got a little puffed up. I'm like, ooh, I look good. You know? Try to get me some extra girlfriends since I'm getting these compliments. And these talent scouts would approach me when I was in college and, hey, you'd be a great model. Come on down and audition. Then they get you out to wherever the audition is, and there's all of these people in one place, and they go through their whole spiel of what they do and get you sitting there for an hour. You got a little refreshments or whatever, hour or two, what have you. And then at the end of it, they trying to get in your wallet. And I was a broke college kid. I'm like, yeah, man, y'all brought me down here. I could have been doing some homework. You done tricked me. Oh, and now I feel bad. I wanted to be a model. They telling me I got all this talent. I got all of this potential. And for only $1,099,
yep.
I can have 6 months in their program. But I ain't got $1,099. I'm living off of FAFSA.
Yeah.
So I, you know, head down. I know I ain't looking like a model walking out of there. Probably all good looking good coming in, feeling good and everything else. Walk out of there. Depleted. And then I learned something watching TV. I got aunts. One of my aunts is a beautician. She owns a salon, and I've got skills in the trades: electrical, carpentry, all whatever. So anytime anything would break, you know, a dryer went down, whatever it was, at the shop, she would call me over and I would, you know, fix it. And they would always have the TV going. They'd be watching stuff like Next Top Model, Tyra Banks, you know what I'm saying? So I'm hanging out with my aunt, whatever, you know what I'm saying? Checking out the views around the salon, whatever I was doing. I was looking at this thing. It was on Tyra Banks, and they was talking about models. And Tyra Banks said, if any modeling or talent scout ever comes to you and it says you got potential, and then they ask you to pay, they're a scam. And I've had it happen, like, a bunch of times. It was like, I thought I was supposed to be, like, the best model in the United States, because like all of the talent scouts were always coming after me, trying to get me to come into their little thing, but then they always wound up wanting me to pay something. It was a scam the whole time. They was puffing me up, gassing me up to take my money. And when I heard Tyra Banks say this thing, I learned something. I had some experience of something negative. I had a lot of experience of something negative. And then when she said that they're a scam, any talent scout that really wants you, they're going to make so much money from you, they don't need you to pay nothing. And then she started going out the rates for somebody, how much somebody... a production gets paid for one fashion model to walk down the runway. And it's like thousands of dollars, like thousands, sometimes tens, sometimes hundreds of thousands of dollars, just for one person to do their little strut on the catwalk, like Right Said Fred or whatever said. And I was like, I got some knowledge. Now I got some understanding. Now I won't be deceived the next time somebody comes up to me and says, oh, you got talent. Why don't you come down here and join Barbizon? That's one of the main ones that does it. One of my ex-girlfriends was a member of Barbizon. Paid a lot of money. She did get some work, though. She got put into some commercials. But it really just fed her ego because she wasn't getting paid enough. She was paying Barbizon, and they were giving her something back when she got a gig. There's exceptions, though. Some people will make it. They got to let somebody in. It's like the lottery. Somebody got to get to the top. They got to show somebody getting up to the top, right? But their money's in their numbers. That census. Trying to get the masses. Mm-hmm. There's got to be an example, you know, of what you can do, though. Right. But that's, you know, that's what I'm talking about. It's not, what I'm talking about is not being deceived. I don't went along enough about me. I ain't not talking about me. I'm just talking about an experience where you have to try the spirit. The founder of this school said he wouldn't give a tinker's damn for a Holy Spirit that has not been tried. It took me a long time to understand that the Spirit that was in me when I was born into this world is the Spirit that I have now. It has not changed. Mm-hmm. I still have the same Spirit. I now have some wisdom, some understanding. I know you don't like to celebrate birthdays, but I thank Yahweh for allowing you to walk the earth plane, Dr. Salas, for 80 years and to be able to, you know, listen and cause you to listen and pay attention and learn something about Yahweh's purpose so that you can express the wisdom, that you can use the wisdom that's been bestowed to you so that we can know something. Mm-hmm. I thank Yahweh for that 80 years that you got. Yeah, not to exalt the man. But I'm just glad that you're still here with us. You know? For as long as we do have you here with us, I'm happy and I'm glad. Because you're my family.
That's right. Yes, that's right.
All of us. I was in a class earlier this morning, Hamilton, Ontario. They always send their love. They have a very good class. And one of the speakers was talking about the, kind of reminiscing in this school when there was a time that the people were proud and happy to be able to say it didn't matter where you went, what state you went into, what city you went into, whose house you went to, if they had been coming to this school, if they were a member of this school and they knew something about the purpose of Yahweh, they were teaching the same thing. Yeah. All teaching the same thing.
That's right.
And, you know, it's not that way anymore. And, it has to be that way. So I'm not sad and down about it because it absolutely has to be that way. You know, one of the things, and I don't worship Dr. Kinley, but I do believe that he did have a divine vision and revelation. And I don't just believe it because he said some cool stuff, and he had some cool parlor tricks. He proved it to my satisfaction and still is proving it to my satisfaction, to be honest, because there is material that was drawn out by that vessel that has been recorded on record, just like the record that John bore, you see, that I haven't heard yet. And I'm still listening. And I'm still trying the spirit that was in the man. And the spirit that was in that man expressed, don't look at the man. Continue where you're at in John.
2. Hereby know ye the spirit of Yahweh. Every spirit that confesseth that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is of Yahweh.
Every spirit that confesses that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is of Yahweh. Now, there's a certain particular series of things that has to take place in order to really and truthfully confess that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh. You have to be able to explain that. Because that's a bold statement to make. And you got to understand what that statement means. Don't look at me. What I eat isn't going to profit you.
That's right.
This isn't about me. The purpose for me standing on the floor right now is for you to come to the conscious realization that you can't escape Yahweh. And at the beginning of his purpose, he declared the word. And that word created everything that there is in the universe. There's nothing other than this.
That's right.
And we want you to know it. Have a profound understanding of that. Because when you do, Yahshua the Messiah is come in your so-called flesh. And what happens then? Before you realize that, you die. Oh, don't get scared, because you still be able to left foot, right foot down the street.
You know.
But you die out of your carnal theories, concepts, and opinions that you thought you knew something about. You gotta die in order to get to heaven. Now, Dr. Salas said Yahweh began in eternity, right? This creation, he began this creation in eternity. And it's going right on back.
It's okay. That's right.
So, your destination is your origin. We want you to become conscious and aware of that now while you have a chance. Seek ye him while he sits on his throne. We got this tabernacle that we can use to explain that. That Dr. Silas was talking about. Moses was shown up here in this mount while he was up there for 40 days. People got anxious, thought he was dead, went on down there, started worshiping the golden calf, what had you. You know, and then he came down pissed off and broke that table of stone that Yahweh gave him. He had to go back up in there a third time to get another set of stone that he had to bring up there himself. You see, but they were disobedient here. They were disobedient for coming down here because they were told to tarry ye here.
Right.
And anything that they had to, you know, do, they could get it from Aaron, right?
Right.
So if they needed some food or they needed anything, Aaron to take care of them. But all they, if they were obedient, then they would have been straight. They wouldn't have had no problem. But they weren't. They went on down here and they got out of, they went operating outside of the that Yahweh's pattern, if you will. They're trying to go in darkness, if you will. See, they weren't conscious. And Moses was up here handling some business. Yahweh had Moses up here for a reason. And if they were conscious, then they would have stayed right here. Just like when we come down to one of these schools, we're not conscious of the purpose of Yahweh. And that's what we are trying to get you to see. Stay right here. You see what I'm saying? Don't move. You've been brought out of Egypt. 40 days. You'll be all right. You got an intercessor here for you that'll take care. Don't be going trying to come down off your housetop. So you got most holy place, top of the mount. Holy place, plateau of the mount. Court roundabout, base of the mount. They were supposed to stay up here in the holy place. They left. They went back down in the court roundabout. Got slashed up good, too, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
By them Levites. Told them up. I don't want to see none of my brethren die. We look at all of these things according to principle, see? We're not looking at what we're going through right now in a literary sense. We're talking about something spiritual. Every spirit that confesses that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is of Yahweh. Continue reading.
And every spirit that confesseth not that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is not of Yahweh.
Every spirit that confesseth not. You try to tell somebody about Yahshua the Messiah. You try to tell somebody about the purpose, pattern, and plan of Yahweh. You try to tell somebody about this tabernacle.
What about the books that was older than that? All the hieroglyphics that were made in Kemet. What about the order of Gilgamesh or whatever you want to, all of that crap.
And then, you know, you tell them, hey, it's as simple as 1, 2, 3. They don't want to hear it. Now we try in the spirit, aren't we? Now what do you do then? You cut them off? Who are you to cut somebody off? Huh. Oh, you just keep on preaching. We come down here, we talk about the same thing every time we come down here. Now somebody want to argue with you out on the street, so you don't want to talk to them no more. You want to cut them off. Don't talk to them no more. See, I got to work. I've been working on my patience. You know.
Yeah.
I've come to realize that the disposition that I've carried, even though I thought it was acceptable.
Yeah. I'm with you.
See, it's got to conform to this.
And until it's conformed to this, then I'm doing the same thing that these boys did. Now, they were chosen. When you come down to one of these classrooms, you're chosen. That's right. You're brought down here by divine invitation. Can somebody turn the air on? Man, we got about 15 minutes. I'm going to be here afterwards. Thank you. You're down here by divine invitation. Like, don't take that for granted. Please, pay attention. Pay attention to what is being taught down here, you know? Most holy place, court roundabout. Back in Revelation, I think we're at about 5 or 6. Excuse me.
Let's see. Six. Mm-hmm. I'll start there. Revelation 1:6. Mm-hmm. And from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, mm-hmm. and the ruler of the kings of the earth, mm-hmm. unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins.
See,
in
he
his
washed
own blood.
Us from our sins. So you want to condemn somebody that, oh, you shouldn't be smoking, you shouldn't be drinking, you know, you shouldn't be doing this, you shouldn't be doing that. Don't be looking at that man's wife. Why you not giving no money to the church?
Saint Angel Council.
You know why? Well, you condemning people trying to tell somebody what they should be doing. Pause, please. I plead with you. Find out what it means, why the Messiah got up on this cross. It wasn't in to bring in a way for you to live, because if he, you know, brought in a way for you to live, get your ass up on the cross at 33 and a half years old and die.
There you go. Prove it.
Get up there and die. If you're supposed to be living like him. No. See, in Jeremiah 31:31, it talks about that Yahweh said he's going to bring, and I excuse my French, I'm sorry. But Yahweh said that he's going to bring in a new covenant, not according to the covenant that he made with the children of Israel, these chosen ones that he brought out of Egypt by a mighty hand. They had this, they was given this law, and we go over this many times, that if they could complete this law, fulfill this law, do all of the things that were commanded to them by Yahweh, that would be their righteousness, and they couldn't. But guess what? This one did. That was their righteousness, you see? This is the fulfillment of that, you see? This law is taken out of the way. And this was for the Jews and the Jews only, right? But when this one fulfilled this law, and he died and was buried and consumed in Joseph's new tomb, that the physical body was consumed, and what rose early Sunday morning and was seen among the Jews. And then on Pentecost, when he poured out his Holy Spirit, when he poured out the Holy Spirit, he poured it out not only on the Jews, on all flesh. What we just read there? What did we just read there? 6 again or whatever?
Yeah. Again?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness, mm-hmm. and the first begotten of the dead, mm-hmm. and the ruler of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins.
That's him washing us from our sins. He's the ruler of the kings of the earth. He is the King of kings. See? Mm-hmm. Read.
In his own blood.
In his own blood. See?
and has made us kings and priests unto Yahweh his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever.
See, that's where we need to give that glory and the dominion is to Yahshua. We don't want to be like him. We want to learn of him. Mm-hmm. When that Holy Spirit takes up residence, when you get some knowledge and understanding of the purpose of Yahweh, see, you can't do nothing but the will of Yahweh through his son. You are taken captive. You are a prisoner. You just have to do it. That's how you can try the spirit. Once you get this thing, once you really see it for the way that it really is, you're going to die just that same way. It's not going away. Mm-hmm. It's just not happening. You're not overthrowing Yahshua.
Oh, no.
We got some faith. I hope you hear me. Simple as 1, 2, 3. Said it. You see? Read.
8. Behold, he cometh with cloud, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Mm-hmm. Yes, so be it. Mm-hmm. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation, and in the kingdom and patience of Yahshua the Messiah, was in the isle that is called Patmos, for the word of Yahweh and for the testimony of Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. I was in the spirit on the Sabbath day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven assemblies, which are in Asia, Ephesus, and unto Smyrna.
I wanted it out of King James Version. Because, yeah, it says I'm the first and the last, the beginning and the ending in Holy Name in the King James Version.
Okay.
I got about 5 minutes.
Gotcha.
See, John saw behind him. He saw behind him that angel.
Yep.
He had to turn. He turned, and that angel was coming towards him. Moses, that angel was before him, and he didn't see his face. He saw his backside. That's what we got on this chart right here. That's what we got in the book. And you can read when Moses went up and he didn't see his face. But go ahead. You got it there where he says the Alpha. I think it's the 8th verse.
Yeah, the 8th verse.
Yeah, right. Go ahead.
I am Alpha and Omega, mm-hmm. the beginning and the end, saith Yahweh.
Now, Yahweh. Now, that's a name. It ain't no title.
That's right.
Yahweh says, I'm the Alpha and Omega. Now, we know that the first translations of what you have here in the fulfillment portion of your scripture, what the book of Revelation is in encompassed in that, was first transcribed into Greek, and Alpha and Omega, I believe that's Latin. Yeah, Greek. Yeah, Greek. It's actually Greek. Sorry. It's Greek. Alpha. Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet. It is Greek. Yeah. It's coming back to me. The Holy Spirit will bring all things back to your remembrance. Yeah. The first letter of the Greek alphabet is Alpha. And Alpha is a masculine character, predominantly. There are alpha females. So we're not going to say absolutely. Somebody get all messed up and don't want to hear what I got to say. Oh, I know about alpha females. It's the alpha character is predominantly masculine. It's assertive. It's the beginning as well. Yah. That Yah portion of the name of Yahweh is masculine. Mm-hmm. Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. And it is predominantly feminine. There are Omega males. Surely there are. But the Omega character receives the Alpha character. Yahweh, together, is both masculine and feminine, right within himself, not needing to go outside of himself to reproduce anything. He is the Alpha and the Omega.
That's right.
He is the first and the last. He is the beginning and the ending. So what Dr. Salas, and I'm almost out of time, what Dr. Salas was talking about was so beautiful to me. Because what he was talking about was, you know, Yahweh set up all of these people, places, and things, and everything that they was doing. Like when they went out and spoiled the Egyptians and got all of their raiment and the gold and the jewelry. And he said, and Dr. Salas was talking about, what they going to use to build this tabernacle? Yahweh already knew what they needed, so he had them get it.
That's right.
Because he declared it from the beginning. And when you read these stories, and when you read these historical accounts, and you pay attention to what's going on according to the pattern, then you can see that Yahweh declared it from the end, from the beginning. You can see it, that you got to have it this way with Adam in order to have it that way with Yahshua.
That's right.
And that's all you need. That's all you need is to see the pattern that Yahweh has drawn out through his creation, repeating over and over and over again, just like we do every time we get up on the floor and we talk about Moses coming to the burning bush, going down into Egypt, 10 devastating plagues getting poured out, dividing the waters of the Red Sea, coming out into the wilderness, being out here 40 years, crossing the River Jordan, going into Canaan land, not being able to take care of that law, and Yahshua the Messiah coming in and fulfilling that law, dying, buried, resurrection, resurrecting, and then pouring out that Holy Spirit. You don't need no more. See, now you got the Holy Spirit. See? Now, it didn't go away. It didn't go away. Mm-hmm. Remember that. Just because he died, he was buried. See, he resurrected. He didn't die again. He poured out his Holy Spirit.
Right.
So now you can live. See, that's the 10th objective of this school, is to inherit eternal life. Now. Right now. We're done?
No, just question real quick, or a little statement.
Go ahead.
When you were stating earlier that Yahweh is the ultimate, and you kept saying ultimate,
mm-hmm.
The etymology of ultimate comes from the Latin root of ultimar, which is the end of a process.
Completion, right?
Completion.
Yeah, he's complete. Complete. See, when you got the beginning, when you got the ending, and it's, you put it all together, you got the Alpha, and you put it together with the Omega, that's the ultimate.
That's right.
The all in all. That's the completion. You lay it all out. Look at it. Try the spirit, whether it be of Yahweh or not. See? You missing some pieces. You got to keep on working. Don't believe what we say, but you make us prove it. Mm-hmm. Don't just shoot off and be like, oh, I don't like what they talking about because I got Jesus. And somebody say it like that so it sound good. I hope and trust that something was got out of what was said today, because, you know, this is the most important thing. There's nothing more important than this. All praises be to Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That concludes today's classes. I'm the moderator. We don't have any announcements in particular. No, I don't believe so. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and your enemies, because this is the place to learn something about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Excellent class. This is awesome.